শ্রীমতী রামার জন্ম। Today's lecture is on food and the topic of the lesson is ontodidactics. Ontodidactics deals with the philosophical as well as multidimensional approach for consumption of food. What to consume, how much to consume, and what are the various parameters of a realistic sattvic food. And it also implies inside, even though it is something connected with consumption of food, our Shastras believe that if food is properly consumed and distributed, food productivity, food security, food distribution services, then it is everything made inside. Proper food consumption, as per the Shastras, that involves also proper food productivity, proper food security and distribution, number one. And number two, we used to take lot of things. For knowledge, we want something. For health and hygiene, we want something. And for nutrition, our survival balance, we need something. For our nutrition and survival balance, we go for food. And for health, we go for drugs, medicine. For knowledge, we go for lot of exercises. For peace, we go for solitude or company or forest or house or fun, whatever it may be. But our Shastra says that food is the only solution for everything. That is the difference between Eastern and Western thought, to consider food as not only a nutrition provider, not only as a biological instigator, but also considering proper food induces you to get mental peace, to get intellectual maturity, to get spiritual solace, to get your own inner realization, for which each and every role of food is very significant in the inceptive level. So food is an initial tool for getting physical, mental, spiritual, social, collective, cultural, moral maturity. Number one, it is not only an initial tool but also is a supportive tool to your other works. Number three, it is an associate tool with all of your spiritual efforts. In your spiritual efforts, it is associative. In all of your endeavors, irrespective of the status, it is supportive and it is an initial step for everything. Western philosophy, they don't bother about food and they are not aware of this multi-level or multi-dimensional penetration of the power of food or the vigor of food in all spheres. So this type of a totalitarian study of food is not there available in the Western philosophy. Whenever we take autodidactics, I want to give these two points which I want to say once again. Number one, if you say about proper food consumption, that is implied with, that is pregnant with, that is incorporated with food management, food productivity, food distribution services, food security, and that is also a solution to the world poverty, world malnutrition, and the world's other various other problems like unemployment and various things. Everything starts from hunger, poverty, and this malnutrition problems. So it is a solution provided to everything. So the first point you have to understand is this type of food consumption is not only consumption, having consumption as a proper methodology by which pre-consumption and post-consumption benefits are indwelling and they are assured, number one. And number two, this is not only a physical nourishment service, it deals with mental balancing, it deals with intellectual sharpness, it deals with the spiritual solace and self-comforting, it deals with comforting others and embracing others, it deals with universal fraternity and brotherhood. With food we can do anything. So Annam Brahma, God can do anything. God is in the form of food. So through food, in the form of God, we can do anything. That is a real philosophy which we are going to discuss in ontodidactics. When we come to this Anna, I believe that this should be also in the syllabus of yoga. Whether in the yoga or Vedanta or Ayurveda, in these three things it starts with Ahara Niyati. Second, it deals with Achara Niyati. Third thing, it deals with Abhyasa Niyati. So Abhyasa is a practice. In yoga, Vedanta and in Ayurveda, the Abhyasa may be different. Yogacharya will be having his Abhyasa, Ayurveda is entirely different. Each and everybody, they will be having their experimentations and practices differently. But they all start from a common substratum or a common substantial base. That foundation is Ahara. Three people, both yoga. There are three schools of thought, wonderful thought. For your physical maturity to reach good balanced mind and intellect, Ayurveda is pushing you up. Making your mind and intellect facilitated for spiritual realization, yoga is pushing up to Vedanta. Vedanta is pushing either you to God or pulling God or dragging God to you by your bhakti. So these are all the three major sciences. All these three sciences, they start with food. So I want to say a few points now. Number one, ahara lakshana or anna lakshana. You write it anna. Ahara is the method and anna is the substance. And dravya is the ingredient. If you say that it is rice, that is the dravya. And while it is in the status of being consumed, whether it is plain rice or cooked rice, that which is consumed, that is known as anna. And the consuming is known as ahara. So the to be consumed element is dravya. The consumable element is known as anna. Consumed, while consumed, that particular element is given the name as ahara. So ahara is consumption and anna is the consumable, and the consumability promoted or promotable or to be promoted element or ingredient is known as dravya. So dravya becomes anna when it is for service. When you utilize the service, it becomes ahara. So anna is the basic name given by the Vedas. Anna maya kosha is the name of the body, not ahara maya kosha or dravya maya kosha. So anna is the spiritual nomenclature for food. And we have given few spiritual nomenclatures for anna also. If you worship God and take that food, it is known as anna. There are three types of worships. One is manasika, second is vyavaharika, third thing is kratusiddha. So that which is by mana, by your mental thought, if you surrender and submit, that becomes anna. If you offer it to God in the form of a kratu, that is a ritual, that becomes havish. The same thing if you offer by vyavahara, not by mere thinking, by doing something, sprinkling water, putting tulsi, that becomes prasad. So anna is the primary nomenclature of divine food. So divinity present inside the food, it is known as immanence. That immanent divinity is known as anna. The provoked divinity is known as havish. The invoked divinity is known as prasad. So these things are very special to us. So let us start with anna lakshana. I don't know whether I can complete this or not, but I will give the full skeleton of this today. One is anna lakshana. What are all the parameters for food? Second thing is anna dravya. We can eat anything. So a barbaric society, cannibalistic society, and nomadic society, all these people, they don't know any limitations. If they are hungry, whatever that is available. And even in emergent cases, we know that in lot of shipwreck cases, the people they used to eat the other people who are left inside the ship. There are stories and there are real incidents. We cannot believe it unless we are subjected to that situation. So that knows no rule. Appetite knows no rule. Only that type of our moral stamina and spiritual courage should give us the energy as a substitute for the food which is not available, and give us the real noble path wherein we can select our food, wait for it, still sustain with more vigor. It should be given by our moral and spiritual courage. Stamina should give it. Otherwise, we will be victimized by surrounding. Whatever that is available, we may take. So we should have that courage. If you develop these things while food is available, we're eating everything comfortably, then at the time of non-availability, we can maintain. You cannot learn things at the time of non-availability of food or with appetite. So that is the problem. One is anna lakshana. Second is anna dravya vijnana. That deals with the ingredients of food. Third thing is anna adhikara. Eligibility or qualifications for the eaters. We are very much seeing about the quality of the food only, not about the eaters. So what are the different types of members of the society? Are they body oriented? Are they mind oriented? Intellect oriented? Or spiritual oriented? Based on that, this type of food classification should be made. A bodybuilder or a muscular mountain, he may require a different type of food. He is not bothered about the mental sturdity or intellect. So that cannot be imitated by a person who is a seeker of mental peace. So adhikara, that is differentiated from a person and his purpose. If you want spiritual benefits, then you have to take such foods which are very much for that. It is like Prasuti Niyama. If somebody is pregnant, they won't bother about what they like or what it is available, what is in abundant, what is cheap. They won't bother about like things. Whatever that is salubrious to the development of the embryo, whatever that facilitates a safer growth as well as a safer delivery of the child, they will concentrate only on that. Likewise, if we are having Brahman inside, if our heart is pregnant with the Brahma Tattva, like we are pregnant in the embryo with the Shishu Tattva, we are also having the pregnancy inside. That is known as Krut Garbha in the Vedas. So we realize that we are also having somebody inside, and accordingly we have to consume our food and restrict our desires and attune our pathway of life of not only food consumption, which will decide each and every moment and behavioral extension of our life. So that is very much essential. Anna Adhikara Nirnaya. Anna Bheda. Even in these things there are varieties of foods. Ingredients are having innumerable varieties. Permutations are there. Thousands of permutations have been invented. Especially India's innovative temper and scientific development is more in cookery. How many variety of dishes? Now everybody is in competition. Everybody is developing their own Italian cuisine, then Chinese. Everybody is in competition. But we have got lot of combinations. There are few treatises which are not known to people, which are based on cookery as per the person's Rashi, Nakshatra and Mandala. Yes, it is astro cookery. If a person's Kundali naturally says that a person is pertaining to Pitta, Vata, Kapha, or this age he may be having diabetes, this age he may be having some degradation, by knowing a person's physical superstructure as well as inner structure, designing the food model as per the seasons, designing the food model as per the availability of grains, designing special models as per the speciality of occasions, designing things as per the constitution and configuration of people. These four types of designs are there in Anga Vibheta or Anna Vibheta Lakshana. These are known as four Angas, different Anga Vibheta. And these four things are to be maintained. One is based on astrology, second is based on physical constitution. The mother knows what is acceptable, what is allergic, energetic and synergetic to the child, can be understood by a child, mother. So that is also a constitutional feeding or configurative understanding feeding that is also done by people. Apart from that, I have given four major schools of thought. Then Anna Parishkara, we are getting something from Mother Earth. We have to repay our gratitude to earth, to water, to soil, to the food grains who are there in the form of Vanaspati, to the god, to the flowers, to the bullock, to the cow, every unit of this thing, we have to respond with gratitude. And that must be something ritualistic and symbolic. Daily, if a person after eating is searching for the farmer, plow, then ox, bullock, cart, mother earth, if he is doing that, he cannot do any other work except eating and paying gratitude in his life. So, a symbolic and composite representation of all gratitude which is given or which is submitted in a common reservoir, either in a Moola Tattva, that is a primordial force which governs everything. It may be a bullock, it may be a cow, it may be a plow, it may be land, it may be water, it may be soil, it may be the minerals and the nutritional contents of the soil, it may be the bija, the seeds, whatever it may be, everything is having two things. One is a common reservoir which is known as Gati, and a common pool or a common origination which is known as Agati. Where it has come from is known as Agati. Where everything is going to end is known as Gati. So we are taking, our religion has taken a riskless and a tiresome free methodology of looking for the Agati and Gati for all of these innumerable ingredients by which we can comfortably pay our gratitude. It is known as Anna Parishkara. How to do three things. One is purification of food. Second thing is vitalization of food. Third thing is sanctification of food. Purification of food is done by two things. One is by gratitude, second is by distribution. It should be given to the right people. Elders in our house, they are the right people. And those who are physically weak, they are the right people. And those who are growing, those people are to be preferred. So, to give priority to the growing people, our well-grown and tottering, ripen old age people, and to the Pitrus, to our ancestors, to the God, and as our Manasa Samarpana, we have to offer it to each and every unit of nature. and it is not going to take any time, or you are not going to really share with God. If God really consumes the food, nobody will offer food to God at all. So it is a procedure by which Anna is purified. You have to give it to the unseen forces, seen forces but distant forces, and proximate forces. Proximate forces are your family members, seniors, worshipable people, guests, and everybody. Distant forces are the plough, farmer, everybody. I have already told that is by manasik, by our mind. Third thing is to the God, the primordial force. We have to do that. Unless these things are done, this gratitude and distribution is maintained, food is impure. That's why Veda say kevala go bhavati kevala di, says the Veda. Any person eating alone, he eats only sin, and that is not food. Why?
Let's see.
Great clapping. So this is Anna Parishkara. Second thing is vitalization of our food. How is vitalization of our food possible? By means of pariveshana. We are doing a lot of exercises at the time of eating food. Abhojana, pariveshana, then antaprana samarpana, antar balidana, pranahuti, pancha pranahuti. By doing these exercises, these rituals, food is vitalized. Number two, even without rituals, a person having proper work, proper determination, free of evil thought, is more powerful to consume less food and to get more energy. So this is vitalization of food. And sanctification of food is done by a person's celibacy, austerity, and other spiritual way of life. So by mere gratitude and distribution, it is purified. By means of physical exercises like work, rest, service, etc., as well as by means of ritualistic exercise like panchapranahuti, etc., food is vitalized. And when a person leads a spiritual design of life, the same food is sanctified. It can give you knowledge, it can give you mental comfort, it can give you liberation, it can give everything whatever you want without the need of any other tool except the food. That is the greatness of food. Then we are coming into Anna Vidhi and Anna Gati. What is Anna Vidhi? Kala Vidhi, Dik Vidhi, Krama Vidhi, Dravya Vidhi, and Upadhana Vidhi. Kala Vidhi means when to eat the food. If the food is not taken, we may have a lot of excuses. We are traveling and we are working. In Apadharma, it is okay. Apadharma means it is somewhere very exceptionally done. Every time whenever we come to school late, we have to purchase a national flag for 2 rupees. When we are studying 7th or 8th standard. And that is not a special honor or merit or a very great national patriotic offer. That is just to also hint, that is not only to promote patriotism but also to promote punctuality. That is one boy, he gave the teacher 100 rupees. I may not be coming this month, I am having lot of work, badminton, exercise and tennis course I am going, I may not come properly. So you keep it for over 45 days, that is 1.5 months. So this is not a proper way. If something is given as an exemption, making the exemption as a regulatory exercise, it is too much dishonest. Likewise, whenever we are in apathy, emergency or unavoidability, we have to see that we can maintain the time or not. That is entirely different. But taking that into consideration, taking every hour of our life to be exceptional, considering our opportunities to be exemptive in nature, considering our status to be so exceptional, we must not misbehave. So there is a kala. At that kala, that period, we have to consume something. See, I want to tell you something. Anybody, akala grahana, kala agrahana. Whenever there is a period for food, if you are not taking anything, your ayush is reduced. Whenever ayukta kala, whenever there is not the time you are taking something, your sampath is reduced. Your productivity, your wealth is reduced. So that's why Shastra say, if there is a proper timing for food, you can design any timing as per your school or other things. That is nonsensical. You have to see, first you have to live. First you have to be productive. That is done by Anna only. Afterwards only you are a professional person, you are an athletic person, media icon, a political idol, or a universal demon, whatever it may be. Everything is based on your body, your life, your health and your productivity. If you are sacrificing everything, that's what you are going to earn and for whom? That is the thing. And if you follow everything,
that will have some sort of genetic erosion, and your children will be the xerox copy of the same thing, same mistakes, and they will do more things. So it will give a very great drastic genetic erosion or aberration, by which the basic principles of maintaining food, water and air, that itself is lost. Now human being can operate aircrafts, he can operate lot of machineries and computational devices, he can operate lot of other rockets and other things, satellites, but he don't know how to operate three things. One is food, second is water, third is air. He don't know how to respire, he don't know how to maintain pollution free water, and how to drink that, how to make water resourceful. He don't know how to eat, and he is not eating at all. He is following this bovinal animals, and he is following cobra and other things, cobra that will swallow. And cobra is not having the digestive juice, supportive juice, just as we are having. We are having three supportive juices. One is the canal juice, and first is the sublingual juice, third is the intestinal juice. We are having three juices, but cobra is having only one juice, very powerful juice. So it used to swallow and then take rest for months together, everything is swallowed inside. We are also taking like that, like cobra, we are swallowing, but we don't have that constitution at all. And bovinal animals, you know that they swallow, then they bring it back to their mouth, then crush it with their jaws and teeth, then sublingual absorption and dilution is made. That provision is not there with us. Can we do like that? But a lot of people are doing like that only. That is that. So we know how we have to take this food. So the time has come for the science, or for the awareness, social awareness or scientific awareness or spiritual awareness. These three awareness campaigns should be made for teaching the human being how to deal with food, air and water. After spoiling everything, who is going to play with the machines? You will be dead, are totally imbecile, are crippled, are paralyzed. Who is going to play the machines and rackets? So after a few generations, if you are not going to be aware or vigilant or meticulously observant in your methodologies, only the world will be filled with machines and crafts, and nobody will be there to operate. So these three things are very basic essentialities. Let everybody invent everything, but we have a very strong intellectual base. Our knowledge service for these sciences. So it is known as Anna Vidhi. First is Kala. That's why I want to say, whenever, there is one more thing in Ayurveda. Whenever you want water, that is a different instinct. Whenever you want solid energy through blood, that is a different instinct. But whenever you are hungry, you are drinking water. Whenever you are thirsty, you are eating something. That is also not good. So we have to say, whenever there is a Yukta Kala, Shastrokta Kala, at that time, at least a handful of something, either it may be a fruit or a vegetable or anything else. Even diabetic people, at that time, if they take a small quantity, it is not going to disturb at all. It is an unwanted fear. Howsoever, maybe the people may be sick or anything, at the regular time, if you take, apart from the time, you see, there are two things. One, for substantially giving the fuel for your operations, that particular time is used. After that only, it is disintegrated into different parts, and glucose, its absorption, everything is made later. That is entirely different. I want to say, if you are taking Yukta Kale, Yadyat Grihitam, Sarvam Tat Sukhatam Bhavet. If you are taking a small quantity at an appropriate time, you need not bother about your sickness or your unadaptability or anything. But it must be the appropriate time, and it should be limited. So I want to say to everybody, at that appropriate time, take something. Don't be empty. At later time, whenever you have your timings, meeting or something else, eating and meeting has lot of clashes. Everybody is postponing their eatings because of meetings, considering that as more significant. But still, they can have a handful of something. They can have pishta, what we call pishta in Sanskrit. They can have the flour of good cereals, germinated sprout cereals. They can carry and do that. Otherwise, they can take a cup of milk, or they can take one or two bananas. It is very simple. One apple, it is not going to harm at all. That particular time, it should be honored. The inner mechanism or the instinctive cause should be honored. It is known as Kala. Second is Dik. We don't know about Dik, which is east, west, we don't know. But Shastra says that we have to see some direction and do that. South is preferred in Shastras for food, because that induces more energy. And a common upachara, common courtesy is east and north. But for food, south is preferable. We will discuss these things later. That is Dik Nirnaya. Dravya Nirnaya, Swami has told us to eat, so we can eat anything. That is the Dravya which we can take. So anything is having innumerable differentiations. Swabhava Tushta. We used to say, what is Swabhava Tushta? That which is naturally prohibited. Ashraya Tushta is that which is not naturally prohibited but circumstantially prohibited. For example, if something has an insect, something has hair inside, something is brought, the Shastra has, for there are three types of people. Those who eat for survival. Second type of people, those who are doing advanced things. Third type of people, those who are doing a tapasya, a lifetime mission in spiritual field. For the third type of people, they are having lot of restrictions, which need not be these people, for these people. If you are not having any scooter, what is the necessity for your helmet? It is not essential at all. There are some exercises which are going to safeguard your tapasya, the penance. If you have no tapasya, then why you are going to safeguard, what you are going to safeguard? So, drashta, a person who sees, parimeshakaha, one who serves, sahabhokta, a person who is sitting and eating with us, panti, the row and the people sitting in the row, drashta, the person who is seeing at the time of cooking, and pachaka, the person who is cooking for that, aneta, the person from whom the ingredients are brought or bought, kalpaka, the person who is cultivating, all of these people's sins and virtues are there embedded inside the food. But they are so subtle, if you are seeing a lot of things, you cannot eat throughout your life. So, maybe the Shastras say that two things are said in Shastras. Number one, it is meant for people, those who are in spiritual mission or mission of realizing inner energy, number one. And number two, they say that these things can be easily propitiated or mitigated by means of mantra. So whatever that is there or there not, whatever there is, the positivity or negativity, whatever it may be, positive induction and negativity reduction, there is a common exercise or prayer which can be done regularly by all people without considering or evaluating or exactly estimating who has done this. So we need not go for this scrutiny, exploration, CBI investigation, etc. We are having the food, whatever it may be, either visible or invisible, let all the sins, let all the evil installations inside, let them disappear. Let the food be a proper suitable tool for me. Let me be a suitable and eligible agent for which we have to recite. So these problems are there, which are very complex, but still the Shastras say that they are for advanced people, number one. Second thing, they are very simply manageable by means of our prayer and mantras. So we need not go for search and research at all. So this is known as Dravya, Dravya Niyama. Fourth thing is Krama Niyama, how to eat. There is a position for eating, but if you eat like that, it will take hours together. But still we can try, I think. So to take the food, and to do that pancha prana huti, then parisheshana, everything, etc. Then take the food, first think about the food, you must taste and relish the food. And there is the inner taste of food, nobody is relishing that. Inner taste of the food, for example, you know that, if you take banana, the banana is having a skin. What is the taste of the skin? So, it is having one more peripheral epidermis. It is known as carpiti. Carpiti is the level of a fruit. It is known as carpus in Greek language, they used to say carpus and carpiti. Carpiti is the system by which a fruit is made. And this carpiti, it has a peripheral skin surface. That will not be tasty. The second layer is the prodermic layer, is that will not be tasty. The inner layer will be tasty like that. So you have to understand, whenever you are munching or relishing the food, initially, you are getting the ingredient taste, that is known as the initial taste. Then, after masticating, that mixes with your lingual juice or sublingual juice, that is the saliva. Then it is processed, then only the inner real flavor that comes. But we don't wait for that time. Immediately, it is put inside. Nobody, I believe that, except few people, nobody, they have never tasted the real flavor of food, that is antaruchi. Our Vishishta Ruchi has not been taken. Everybody is taking only the Shariraka Ruchi. They are not considering about the Antarik Ruchi. So we have to taste that. Then it should be forwarded to this canal. Then it should go inside. So that is known as the Krama. So we have to take it, taste it, find the inner or the finer taste or the finest taste of offering. That's what I told in my lecture on this Pancha Diksha, which is conducted at Rajbar. I told a devotee should be able to distinguish, closing the eyes, which is homemade food, which is hotel made food, and which is a hermit made food, and which is a food made at a holy place like temple. So holy food, hermitage food, hotel food and home food, these four H must be distinguishable for a person who has spiritual identity. Without saying, So that cannot be possible by means of our mere vision or our peripheral vision or scrutiny, because most of the places, hotel food may be nicer than home or even a holy place. So to taste that inner ingredient, we need a different taste bud, which I am going to say today. So this is known as krama, and then upadana, which is the best container to cook or to eat. The Shastra says that there are a lot of subtle laws while we are cooking in some ingredients. Now it has become, everything has become
microwave
oven is there, then pressure cooker is there. They are entirely different. If we go too much inside, then we will feel like vacating the houses and going somewhere. So Bhartana Shastra says, at least at the time of puja, at least at the time of good things, mud is preferable. Even in temple, they used to make it with mud pots. See, whenever people were handling mud pots, it was developing the pottery, number one. Number two, it was developing care, meticulous care and handling technology and patience with people. Without patience, without handling skill and tactics, or without having that type of observation and these things, vigilance, we cannot handle those issues. So at that time, patience developed and pottery also developed. Now pottery is also not there, patience has also gone out of people. So that thing, occasionally we have to use that. At least at the time of any special festivals and occasions, we have to use that. Plantain leaf, nobody is using plantain leaf. Because of non-availability, they are saying, somebody said to me, as they are not available, we are not using. Then I told that, reciprocate it. As you are not properly using, those issues have become obsolete and non-available. The more you use them, the more you honor them, more their productivity will be there. That is our Vedantic vision. And the more they are available, we can use. That is a modern vision, which is a very, very wrong ideology. More you honor things, automatically it will usher up the people to do some sort of productivity. It will instigate the productivity at all. So the other thing is Ahara Gati. What is Ahara Gati? It has three gatis. I have already told, one is Asya Gati, and second is Marga Gati, third is the Kukshi Gati. There are innumerable hormones and enzymes. There are Sanskrit equivalents for that. Each and everything what it is doing with the food is there. What are all the dust and dirt? It is removed by one enzyme. What are all the insolubles? They are made soluble in one enzyme. Wherever those things are not breakable by the intestinal juice, those things are broken. See, elementary school teacher prepares the child to go for high school. High school teacher for high secondary. They for college. Like that, this preparation inside makes it to travel inside the food channel. And here it is made for intestine. Intestine makes it very sufficiently adaptable for the bodily enzymes through blood supply. So these things, hundreds of enzymes are there. They make solubility, they make compatibility, they make toxic reduction, they make toxic excretion, they make energy boosting, they make energy adaptability to various things. There are soft tissues, softer tissues, softest tissues. So based on their saushtava, based on their mardava, based on their swikriti, these things are tuned by various juices inside, which are having Sanskrit equivalent names as well as equivalent deities also, with mantras and other things. So it is known as gati. And Shastra says, whatever the food that you take, it has three pathways. One is gunamarga, second is malamarga, third is urjamarga. Whatever that is going inside the body, that is known as urjas. Whatever that is coming out of the body, that is known as mala, excretion. Whatever that is going inside your spirit in the form of a cloud with the qualities or characteristic determination, that is known as guna. So if you take a food, one third of the food, that goes as guna. What is that guna? Sattvika, Rajasa and Tamasa. That's why our Shastra say that your character is determined by the food. Then why people are eating food and behaving different? There are a lot of non-vegetarians who are very silent, patient and helping others. Lot of people are there. And there are a lot of vegetarians who are, most of the people, most of the great dictators and most of the great autocratic and tyrant people, there have been a lot of people who are vegetarians and fruitarians. Even that Veerappan, who was very famous in Tamil Nadu, we claim that he was not a vegetarian, but he is a great worshipper. So worship, vegetarianism, these things are available even with cruel people. How it is possible? Is it a mismatch or something? We want to say, if in this Janma he is having vegetarianism or something, that is a prarabdha samskara. That is, he has started vegetarian now. That vegetarianism practice has been started now. It is known as arabdha. What is it known as? Arabdha. Just now it has started. Whatever he is behaving now is prarabdha. that which has started earlier. Purvameva arabdaha yakramaha prarabdaha praharishena purvam arabdaha prarabdaha sadhyaha sampratika arabdihi arabdaha. That which has started now, that is known as arabdha. That which has started earlier and the maturity is manifesting now, that is prarabdha. So this is how Shastra's answer. So if a person is vegetarian, still he is very arrogant, still he is ferocious. If he is a non-vegetarian, he would have been more. If a non-vegetarian, if he is very amicable, compassionate and everything, etc., if he is tuned with the food habits also, the qualities will be intensified. This is how we want to say. So food is having sattvika, rajasa, tamasa. That we have to identify, that we will discuss in the lessons. So these are all the various basic pillars of the food science. That is the ahara lakshana, ahara dravya, ahara adhikara, ahara vibheda, ahara parishkara, ahara gati, ahara vidhi. So it deals with modern concepts. Encompassingly we have to say in English, we can deal with food, feast, fasting, cultivation, distribution, all of these various issues, whatever we call now, everything is included here. So you can note down, what is food, what is food, and what is feast, and what is fasting, what is offering, what is cultivation, what is distribution, what is nutrition, what is diet, what is vegetarianism, everything will be the English subtopics covered inside. So I want to give a glimpse of all of these various things without going much deeper. Number one, first exercise what we have to learn is not to produce more food or eat more food. What is fasting and how to take limited food? In English we used to call it as abstemious habit. First is fasting, second is being abstemious. Everywhere they are bothering about only one side. Produce more food, eat more food, eat this, that, eat every hour, eat in your house and also hotel. On the way there will be a shop in the street, you eat there also. Is this the way of developing food security? That is total food insecurity, food alarm. Anna samhara. So we have to understand these things. Shastra says about four things. Dvesha, nasha, lesha and dusha. What is dvesha? So many people, they cannot eat. Because they don't have appetite and digestion. So many people, what are the curses of the world? First is dvesha. So many people, they cannot eat. That is the problem. Dvesha. Nasha, lack of food grains are wasted. Bhusha, so many people are tirelessly eating throughout the day without having any other work. That is anna bhusha. Anna lesha is few portions of the world, they don't have food at all, or they have few food. So that results in hunger strike, as well as malnutrition. So there is anna dvesha, there is anna lesha, anna bhusha and anna nasha. It is not only rhythmic but also systemic. Or more, becoming more catchy, we used to say in a rhythmic style, but still it is something very much well connected and well organized, systematically understood. So somebody told, one person who eats once a day, what is his name?
Yogi.
Huh?
Yogi.
Okay, eats twice?
Rogi.
Eats thrice?
Rogi.
Eats four times?
Rogi.
So, it is not only a stipulation, it is the ability of a person. Yogi should eat once a day. Only once a day means, it does not mean that you should eat only once a day and you should suffer and struggle for the whole day. Yogi should eat only once a day means, yogi is the person who has such a physical stamina which can effectively, tirelessly function with one time of food properly without destroying the inner mechanism. It shows the ability of a person. It does not show the, because it is coercive practice of a person, it is not shown there. You follow that? So, anna must be taken like that. So, limited eating and fasting. Fasting should give you energy. If fasting that absorbs your energy and makes you tiresome, your fasting is wrong. Fasting is acceptance of inner energy, whereby you don't require outer energy and a voluntary or what we call a deliberate system of avoidance of external food and totally torturing oneself, it is not fasting. So fasting can be done provided A person can get the inner energy by which he is, does not feel the absence of any outer support by food ingredients. That is the greatness of fasting. And number two, we must distribute food to all. Sajiva, pratijiva, havihi, nivedana. These are the distributions. And sajiva means to our own people. That is guests to our acharyas, worshipable people, relatives, friends, everybody, our own family members, we used to do that. And pratijiva is we used to feed also in Panchamahayajna. We used to feed also crows, we used to feed ants, we used to feed innumerable things which is not there in other practices. So we used to feed that. That is known as pratijiva. These are all the methods by which our consumption becomes less. That means with a small quantity of food, we can do 10 times more the work which we are doing now, which we are refusing to do now, which we are incapable of doing now. Number one. Number two, food productivity and security is also induced. So for inducing food productivity and security, not only cultivation is the method, fasting is a good method, contentment is a good method, distributing food to others is a method. So this is the angle of perception of our own food technology. So havihi is given in rituals and nivedana is daily offered. Whatever we eat, we have to offer to God and eat. Offer it in the puja room, offer it in the dining table. Christians, they used to recite thanks for the bread given by God. We can do it with mantras, with more bhava, we have to do that. Third thing, our physical constitution has been degraded. We are having two problems. One is shakti skalana, second is maladhikya. According to our physical constitution, the excretion or the portion excrete should be lesser. It is more than the food now. So that proves that shakti skalana, the energy ingredients are not digestible by the bodily enzymes by which they come out. So this type of thing put as manure is more powerful or more nutrient than that of the real food which we are eating, because most of the energy enzymes that are there in food, that is lost by soil erosion. Second thing, they are lost by fertilizers. Third thing, they are lost by overcooking. Fourth thing, they are lost by physical incompatibility. Everything is lost, what we are eating. So that is why I always used to thank God, oh God, there is nothing in whatever he eats, but still I am capable of doing something because you are inside me. If you look scientifically, not spiritually, you can understand that there is some other force working with us, without which naturally nobody can behave like this. Four type of erosion: soil erosion, erosion made by fertilizers, by overcooking like spicy oily cookings, etc. And fourth thing, untimely eating and our inbuilt constitutional deficit that has made food nothing but. There is no difference between food and cow dung. There is only one difference, but that cow dung is very useful. Yeah? This is the status of food now. So this is our physical constitution. Kindly note down. These things are not humorous. One is maladhikya, second is shakti skalana. Physically, our body is not in a position to adapt the nutritious ingredients and to supply to all parts of the body. It is doing little bit, but not to the level that it is expected to do. So that is that problem. And I want to say one more thing. Sattvika, Rajasa and Tamasa I have already told. In vegetarianism, whatever you call as something vegetarian, it means that most of the food elements are there in the form of vegetables or vegetarian cycle or vegetarian family. That does not mean that all vegetables can be consumed. That is not like that. So even in the case of milk, which is an organic byproduct, it is not a product, it is a byproduct, we are getting a lot of benefits. Shastra says that it has sattva guna inside. And even things like drumstick, potato, onion and garlic, they are from the vegetarian family, but that is prohibited. So if you consider the external or the peripheral surface, that it is beef, it is pork, it is meat, it is flesh, etc., then vegetarian and non-vegetarian is different. If you functionally consider, then whatever 1 gram of beef can induce tamasic inside, 10 times more can be induced by a drumstick. So you are consuming the same beef quality in a vegetarian shell. Then what is the use of this ahara? So this is not meant for common people who are working. For example, if there is a farmer, he takes pariyushita. He takes the food which has been prepared the 2 days before or the yesterday's food. He mixes with curd and he takes with his onion and he works. By his hectic work, everything is dissolved and everything is vaporized. We are not like that. For those people, those who are not for any spiritual progress, they are not low intentional, and they are also meant for hard work. That is okay. That is digestible. We cannot do the same thing. So we are having a status. We are having a purpose, we are having a way of life, so we have to adapt our food like that. Now we are not doing like that. So drumstick, onion, this bottle gourd is there. This bottle gourd is very, very, very prohibited in the Shastras. It is very, very clumsy and despicable. It is despicable than anything else. It has panchamrita. Here. It has been condemned in the Shastras. Watermelon is very much condemned. Galanjam na bhakshayet. There is a shloka also for that. Watermelon is very condemned. But still what I want to say is, minimize them or don't adopt them at the time of your pujas and auspicious occasions. So this is the Anna Niyama. Second thing, Anna as a canal. What is it? Anna as a canal. What is Anna as a canal? Anna supplies two energies. It has two containers in which we can supply positivity or negativity. We can mix poison with food. We can mix drugs or medicines with food. We can mix mantras with food. Food is compatible with four things. One is kriya, that is abhichara, shunya and other things. It can easily be adopted by food. You can spoil somebody by food very easily. We can give you marana, mohana or bhedana. You can attract a person by giving some mantras in food or mixing something in food. The person will be attracted, that is mohana. A person will be made a lunatic, provided he is not before. That is bhedana. And third thing is marana, closing the person's chapter. Then it is done by people, it is done by close friends. I used to interpret the close friend is a person who closes his friend or closes the doors whenever he sees the friend. So this type of food is so susceptible and vulnerable to negative inductivity. So we can give drug, we can mix poison, we can mix it with mantras. We can give with any evil sorcery or deed by which the impact will be easily absorbed inside. Likewise, we can do good things also. We can improve sneha, we can improve preeti, we can improve bhakti, we can give solution and salvation also. That is by positivity adaptation. There are two stories. Yadav Prakasha is the Acharya for Sri Ramanuja. And he was just a lizard in his previous birth. And when the Paishacha means there is a demonic attribution or attrition or possession for a royal princess. Then Yadav Prakasha went there for doing some exorcism. Then that particular spirit told, hey Yadav Prakasha, how you have attained this Brahminhood and Vedic knowledge? I know that you may not be knowing. You are like just a lizard and you are just crawling in the remains of a Vaishnava's foot. And due to that contact by a great Vaishnavite, devoted, scholarly person's remains, and your just contact with them has made you to be a Brahmin and a learned scholar. So it is the benefit of contact of good person's food. And Rishyasringa was a born celibate and totally he is avert. He is feminophobic, like androphobism, that is feminophobism, he is afraid of women. He does not know over anything at all. And he refused to come out of that forest. Then the people who wanted to bring Rishyasringa to the kingdom, for wherever Rishyasringa he steps, there will be rain and prosperity. So they planned to bring him, but he refused. At that time, they invited few prostitutes who were available there, and they asked the prostitutes to prepare some food. And through some Rishi Kumaras and some people who are closer to Rishyasringa, they made that food to be served to Rishyasringa through them. After taking that food 3 or 4 days, voluntarily he accepted and he came to that place. But that was used for some good purpose. For any good food and its influence, the first is example. To change any mind, the second thing is example. If you are so vulnerable, if the inducer is so capable and potentiable, certainly this transformation will take place. If it is not taking place, either you may be not compatible or the person may not be competent. So between competent person and compatible person, certainly a mega transformation can take place with food at all. I am giving food in our ashram for several months, no transformation is taking place. Only few transformations have taken place in me. So this is also possible. This thing is also possible. And one more thing what we are willing to say is Sajatiya Vaividya, Vijatiya Vaividya. In the world we are having various differential status of food. We are having non-vegetarian, we are having fishes, and we are having egg and other things, we are having various types of foods we are having. Follow that. So what is Vijatiya Vaividya? Means different options of food. Because to maintain food security and distribution, God has given different options of food. And even within that sajatiya vaividhya, even in the not prohibited things, even in the acceptable things, there are a lot of varieties. I want to say, there are a lot of pulses, cereals and various things available, grains available. Only few things are very much focused, accentuated and used. That is also the reason for lack of food security and lack of food proper distribution. Why scarcity is there? Because all lands are not uniform. God has given sorghum, maize, pearl, millet, innumerable things are there. They can grow, each and every land has its own crop. There is no land given by God where there cannot be crop. It is useful for some purpose. So these alternative systems, these alternative grains are not used by people at all. Everywhere they are dependent on rice or wheat. It is not there. Then vegetables, eating fruits, all these substitutions are organized, balanced way of food is not there. So we have alternatives of fasting, limited eating, we have alternatives of taking alternative cereals and pulses. We are having alternatives of taking just vegetable sauce and other things, just fruits and other things, suitable to all landforms where we can cultivate them, produce them more. As everybody is focusing on a single thing, there is scarcity, there is unadaptability, the land is also being eroded. Land positions are mismanaged. There is an inner inherent design for each and every land to potentialize or to vivify certain crops. That thing is being mismanaged by over-exploitation or over-cultivation or over-consumption. This should also be understood by people. And one more thing I want to say, I have told you also in diabetes lecture, diabetes is a crime, punishment, or diabetes is a curse that is given by Mother Earth and nature. Diabetes is a punishment. You see, I want to say something. Technology, you have invented everything. There is a big blow to technology. Human being is born to walk. Technology, what it should have done? It should have done the natural mechanism of a body to develop its enzyme, to digest everything and to be potentialized without walking. That has not been done. They have invented automobiles. So transportation to human beings, body should be processed by hard labor. And there are two things. Either you must develop energy in rest or develop energy in work. Work, it is known as udyoga, rest, it is known as yoga. Developing energy by work is known as udyoga. Developing energy by rest is known as yoga. And now, lot of people are working, but no rest. And most of the people are taking rest alone, not work. How these people will survive in the world? So, the body, it is refusing to adapt the ingredients and to digest them and to assimilate them. Now we are seeing that. Everybody is born diabetic. Everybody is born with three things. Loan of Mother India, the inheritance of all the mistakes of their parents, the third thing is diabetes. So these things are like Kavacha Kundalas for Karna, each and everybody is born with these things. Debt, diabetics and destiny of the parents, three D's. So we are born to work. We are born to work. We are born to build our back. We are born to walk, we are born to climb everything. Now there is lift, everything is there. You are not working at all. Intellectual work is not a proper work. Divine intellectual work is entirely different from unilateral intellectual work. Unilateral intellectual work does not bind soul with you. What is the difference between intellectual work in IT industry and the same intellectual work in Vedanta Vichara? One, it is connected with soul. This intellectual work is connected with soul. Whenever you are doing these things, naturally the body accepts something. I want to say about Pancha Shakti. What is it?
Pancha
Shakti. There are five Shaktis which most of the people may not be knowing. One is Vardhani. Second is Parivartani. Third thing is Daini. Fourth thing is Karshani. Fifth thing is Poshani. What is the power of this first energy? Even if you consume, you are saying that mere grass is consumed by these animals, but they get a lot of energy. How much work they do? Elephants and things, we are seeing now. So Vardhani as an inner mechanism by which whatever you are getting from the outside, that energy is multifold, made multifold, developed much. So whatever you are taking through food, even though it may be a lesser quality or quantity, that energy is multi-intensified by an inner wheel. That Shakti is known as Vardhani. Second thing is Parivartani. It is also very essential. For example, if there may be a food grain which may be having only starch or carbohydrate, or it may be having vitamin A or vitamin B, few ingredients. It may not be having the other ingredients. But surprisingly, if you consume them, there is a parivartani inside which will take the essential enzymes available. Rest of them will be kept for two things. One is for reservation and second is for refinement. What is reservation? The body stores some energy. Each and every cell is having a reservoir, a reserve and serve. Reservoir is, it can produce energy. Number two, it can store some energy received, that is reserve. It can induce energy for functions, that is known as serve. Serve, reserve, reservoir. That's why even without food, even without water, we can live for a few days or weeks. There is a possibility because of the reservoir and reserves. So this parivartani is a shakti, it is an energy by which even if you consume something, for example vitamin B, of 70 units, it will take the 20 units which is essential for you, and the rest 50 will be disintegrated and reconfigured as vitamin B, vitamin K, vitamin D, or whatever that is essential. Now you are taking, for eye I am eating this, for nose I am eating this, for heart I am eating this. It is not so. Our real body mechanism, whatever you take, even it may be unilateral, even it may be something secular, even it may be something specific, it can be converted into any other thing that is required for your body. That capacity is there inside the body. That is known as parivartani. Daini is there in homeostasis. What is homeostasis? It is known as oja. I used to say oja in Sanskrit. In Shastras, it is known as homeostasis. At the time of any physical ailment, at the time of any physical perplexity or predicament, it can secrete its own medicine. That energy is there inside, which is known as daini. And fourth thing, at the time of tapasya, even if you don't eat, from the reservoir it can take care of you for any number of days. That is known as poshini. Even if you respire, even if you take mere water, even if you take dry leaves, it can give you energy. That is known as karshani. That which extracts energy from dry leaves, that which extracts energy from mere water and mere air respiration, that is known as karshani. So these five energies are there with all human beings, Americans, Africans, everybody, and even available with all animals. But animals have no necessity for practicing these things. But we have the necessity. It is a special grant. It is a universal grant given by God. Especially it is available for our realization, distribution and elevation. It is certainly essential for all of this. It is known as panchasiddhi. So diabetes is nothing but the punishment for mismanagement of work and food. You are not working properly. Everything you are doing with machines. And your intellect is not bided with soul for operations, so it is not substituting your physical energy. Whereas in tapasya, as it is a soul connected intellectual exercise, you are supplied energy, here you are deprived of the energy. So this is very much essential. So work mismanagement and food management, it is there visibly seen in the form of diabetes. So we have to manage our food systems. And we have to manage our work system also. Work and food are interrelated. If you are not having work and food as a compatible system, you are not going to win at all. The second thing I want to say is there are a lot of repulsions, nirakarana. One is asya nirakarana, antar nirakarana, kukshi nirakarana, sharira nirakarana, niyati nirakarana. There are a lot of repulsions. Something your taste buds, they won't like. Here it won't like the taste buds. It will repel. Something you can catch your nose and you can swallow, but it will be repelled here. Initial repulsion or internal repulsion. It may be an excretive repulsion or it may be an emetic repulsion. It may come out in any form. The third thing is sharira. It may be accepted by your, for example, a lot of people are eating non-vegetarian and drinking. The mouth is also accustomed to that and the intestine is also well settled for that. But the sharira is not accepting. Liver is spoiled, then lungs are spoiled. That is sharira. Even in eating something like a drumstick and other thing, etc., neither your taste buds repel them, neither your body repels it, nor your intestine repels it, but niyati. There is a rule for your spiritual progress and spiritual status that will repel all of these foods. So some food will be repelled by your taste buds, something by your intestinal buds, something by your bodily constitution, something by your spiritual configuration. So there are four repulsions inside. Prohibited food are the lack of four foods are prohibited. What are they? Stale food, spicy food, canned food, processed food, preserved food, oily food, juicy food without having that particular fiber,
all of these things are totally to be condemned. So we have to take a proper system of food. That's what the Shastra says. And even one more thing, finally I want to say, this ahara ruchi is based on our samskaras. If you have real samskara, you will select the real food. If a person is taking the proper food, he will go in the proper path. That's why the Shastras, Veda says, ahara shuddhau sattva shuddhihi, sattva shuddhau dhruva smutihi, smriti ambhe sarva granthi naam vipramokshaha. It is a Chandogya Upanishad. If a person has proper food selection, with proper desire, he will reach a proper direction. Reaching the proper direction, he will reach proper practice. By proper practice, he will get realization and he will be liberated. So food is not only something to supply energy for our material functions, it is also a very great energy which can give everything by real food. By taking real food, if you say, take food in your hands and say that Shriyai Namaha, and then take it, it will produce all wealth. Ojo si ojo me daswaha, balamasi balam me daswaha, satyamasi satyam me daswaha, jnanamasi jnanam me daswaha. There are Vedic mantras. If you say that is food, that is just food. If you say that is ojas, it is ojas. Whatever you understand, if you say water is water, then it is water. If you say water has electrolysis, then it has that thing. If you say water can give you electricity, it can give you like that. If you say water can cure diseases by Tirtha and Abhimantana, it will do that. It depends upon the methodology of your approach and proper person available with your stable belief. So food is everything for you, and this is a proper introduction to the food technology or the food science of our land. Next, I hope that we will have a different session in which we can go for Padartha Viveka or Padartha Vibhaga. We can take about rice, we can take about wheat, barley, oats, each and everything we can take. What is the guna, how it will act with people. Then we can take cereals, pulses, vegetables, fruits, flowers, whatever the things that we eat. We can specify each and every them, and we can also start the exercises, how to do Parishkara, how to do Bhagavad Arpana, how to do Antar Arpana, how to take food inside in the form of a ritual or sacrifice, how to offer food to God, how to offer food to people. See, it is said in Shastras, any person who is not feeding great people, the Shastra say that a person who is not visiting holy people and places, he is a dead body. A person's place, in the pretext of privacy, we are not allowing anybody. In the pretext of our business, we are not meeting anybody. Then what is that? Any person not meeting anybody is a dead body, is a corpse. Any person who is not arranging any meeting in his house with any holy people or good people, that house is a graveyard. So we are all graveyards and corpses now. We have to mobilize a lot of things now. We have to get back to our culture in which at least occasionally, weekly once or monthly once, we have to feed guests, we have to invite people, we have to go to holy places and feed them. We have to know how to feed with atithis, how to feed with the dina janas, how to feed the bandhus, how to feed the acharya, how to feed the antaratma, how to feed the jwalagni or vaishwanara inside, how to feed the sarvavyapi bhagavan, and how to feed surya and other things. It is known as panchanga. What is panchanga? It deals with number one, bhu, that is earth. Second thing is rishabha, I have already told, bullock. Third thing is dheru, that is a cow. Fourth thing is bija, that is the seed. Fifth thing is jala, that is the water. These things are the five components of food. Food is not a separate component. Food is a conglomeration of these five components. Water, earth, then soil, that is earthy soil. The surface of the earth is known as land, and the substance of earth is known as soil. Somebody asked me this question. What is earth, what is land, and what is soil? Earth is the crust. Surface is the land and substance is the soil. So likewise, first is the land, soil or earth, whatever it may be, bhu. Second is water. Third thing is dheru. Fourth thing is rishabha. Fifth thing is the bija, the seeds. There are the five components. So we have to take a collective or a holistic view of this food. So this thing is possible only by us. So we have three specialities. Having a whole structured focus of food is with us. Number two, apart from mere food productivity, lack of austerities and principles of food consumption, ethics of food consumption, it is known as food ethics or consumptive ethics, it is that developed by us, number one. Number two, number three, number one I already told, holistic view. Second thing is consumptive ethics. Third thing is food as a panacea for everything, for health, wealth, prosperity, harmony, universal peace, prevention from disasters, everything can be organized only through food, easily through food, rather than radar and satellite predictions and other mechanical and technological these things. So next session,
Certainly, we will need an elaborated session. Whereby, if I am having a board, I think that I can talk very slowly, I can write things, you can note down. 1 or 2 hours it will take. You will learn less, but you will learn. Now you are hearing, you are not learning. Hearing is different from learning. So, if I conduct a class, teaching is different from lecturing. Lecture means to make you know what is there in the Shastras. And teaching is make you know what you have known. That I have to do the next time at least. So, make your blackboard and chalk is available or a marker available. 2 hours we can take class with question and answers. And it will not be with mic, everything at all. Everything I will write, then you can rewrite. Very slowly we can do. I believe that this also should have. There are a lot of home science colleges like Avinash Nigam College. Lot of home science colleges are there. Wherever they are having a BSc in food nutrition and dietetics they are having. But we should develop BSc in onto dietetics. That deals with feast. How to conduct feast? Why to conduct feast? By conducting feast, we are getting 3 things. One is evil eye. We are getting 3 apacharas. If you distribute food to all people, do you think that they are all flattering you? They will put their envious eyeball on you. You will get lot of envy, hostility, and lot of jealousy and partiality from those people. Lot of evil things are brought in feasting. It is not like that. All people are not like-minded. That is there. Secondly, criminal wastage of food. In all feasts, certainly these things are unavoidable. Criminal wastage of food. Third thing, food does not reach the people who are in need of that. Those who don't deserve that. Let it be saad or prasad. Saad should go to the people who are hungry for food, and prasad should go to the people who are thirsty for divine union. Prasad should go for the divine thirsty. And those who are belly hunger, those who are affected with belly hunger, for them they should go. Either a spiritual hunger or biological hunger, they should be fed with saad and prasad. This peace to none of the people are so much deserving. So it gives you evil eye, it gives with our compatibility, incompatibility with the deservingness. Third thing is criminal wastage, nasha, anna nasha. So by doing this feast, we are only enjoying the ill benefits, we are not getting any benefits at all. So we are purchasing sins and sorrows by spending thousands of rupees and feeding people. Spending 50,000 rupees, we are purchasing sufferings with 40% discount. That is what we are doing there. So, onto dietetics, I have already told, it deals with food. What is food? What is feast? What is the systemic scientific study of fasting? What is the systemic scientific study of offering? What is cultivation? What is distribution? That is government distribution, public distribution services, agencies, research, etc. What is distribution? What is nutrition? Really, what do we mean by nutrition? What is real dietetics? And what is real vegetarianism? I have already told, vegetarianism is not only taking vegetables, taking prescribed vegetables is vegetarianism. Taking any vegetable, it is not vegetarianism. For example, shikaka is also coming from a tree. Can we take that? It is not like that. Vegetarians, you should be selective where to take, what to take like that. So, I think that Sujata Vidya, already I discussed about a lot of topics like that. But still, as it is very much formal, I told that today this century is not only India century, it is a century for the people to understand about the ethics of handling food, air and water, I have already told. Without which there won't be any century at all. There will be nobody to record the century after 200 years. So we have to learn that auto-dietics, if we do from India, from this intellectual city of Pune, especially from the Supra Research founder, especially from the India International Multiversity, certainly it will be a pride and honor and a crown to all of us. It will be an enthronement to all of our endeavors. It will be a divine sanction to all of our tireless efforts that we have done throughout various decades. We have been doing that. So I believe that next session will be more elaborative. And BSc or MSc, at least let us start with even diploma. We are already for a diploma now. Let it be a diploma course for 3 months in onto dietetics. So this is the end of today's lecture. I think that we have productively ended this lecture by allowing us to get into a very big royal pathway of getting the imminent possibilities of immanent wisdom or immense wisdom. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.